And welcome to another episode of the Double J podcast. I'm your host, Josh, and I am joined by the not so J, but J for the sake of this podcast, Gerald. How's it going, man?
All right. But you just call me Jerry. That's okay. We discussed that on the last program. It's great to be back. Tell Justin he can, you know, stay on that sick leave. It's okay.
No, he's probably enjoying it. So, you know, this is a union. So he just kind of, I'm the supervisor. I just kind of watch him work and all that. So
as long as I don't have to pay dues.
All right. Well, let's see. There's a lot happening in the movie world this week, but nothing super amazing.
There's no earth-shattering things, but that doesn't mean you shouldn't stay tuned, because we're going to talk about some good stuff.
Yeah, but first, I feel like I need to ask this, Gerald. What have you seen lately that's any good?
Oh my gosh, that's any
what,
good.
What have you seen that's not good? Let's go both sides of the spectrum there.
Well, The Arrival, I did not poo-poo on it as much as you have. Let's put that for record. I recently saw that, like I said, on last week's program. And while I don't think it's best picture quality, because you and I both know the Oscars are right around the corner, I don't think it is as bad as you say, but I also don't think it's as good as everybody likes it either, because I think everything transpired too slowly. And then while it does have the neat little twist that's out there as far as how the movie evolves.
Is it a twist though? It's kind of, okay, let me ask you this. When you walked into the theater and you saw the first few minutes of it, and then you get like maybe 30 minutes into the movie, were you like, okay, something's going to happen. Like it's almost predictable in the way that it's delivered.
But as far as the time shifts, for me, as far as the shifting, as far as what the flashbacks are in the film and flash forwards and all those things, the way they were placed, basically what it did is it took the standard way of doing film with a flashback or a flash forward and basically chopped it up in little pieces and like spread it out all over the film. And if you're not paying close enough attention, yeah, you're not going to be able to pick it up at the very beginning or in the middle, and then you're just like surprised at the end. But like you said, obviously you caught on real quick to where it was going and where it was heading. Me, as far as just watching it casually, around the halfway point where I started realizing that what was going on as far as the different time frames are concerned, and I'm trying to be generalistic, no spoilers now, sorry, because I know it's still in the theaters technically. So I just will say this, like it just transpired the whole thing on a very slow rate for me. That was just it, and it never really picked up enough for my satisfaction. I didn't like the fact that they didn't delve into the aspect of anywhere around the world. I would have been interested into seeing what was going on in China, what was going on in other parts of the world with the other entities that, as you know, in the commercials, in the trailer that you see, are parked all around the world, and how they dealt with those aliens as well. That would have been nice to see indeed.
My big thing, it's not the twist and it's not the politics of it. It's the concept of what they were here to give us. What a crappy gift. Who would want to see that? That is if someone came up to you and said, hey, Gerald, let me tell you the exact moment of your death and how it's going to happen, would you say, okay, yeah, tell me?
Well, if I can try and avoid it, yeah, I will just say on X amount of day, X amount of time, and you're going to do this and here. And then I would just say, okay, well, I will try not to be there. Because it doesn't, if they're giving you the option to see, again, spoilers that are out there, sorry, don't listen for the next few couple minutes. And if they're giving you this gift of trying to see as far as into the future or look into your past and see different realms as far as how's that layout, and tells you, okay, this is what's going to happen to you then. It's kind of cheating in a way, but hey, if I'm told that, then I probably try to avoid it and try and change that future as best as I could.
Okay, so let me ask you this from an objective standpoint. They say that time travel is one of the biggest cop-outs in storytelling. And, you know, the Flash series on the CW is good, and they do it well, but that's like the entire series revolves around that. But how do you think Arrival handled it?
Well, again, like I said, they just basically used it like a, you know, like putting Parmesan cheese on a pizza and just like put it out there and just sprinkled it in all different kinds of time frames, and they just threw it all over the place. And it ended up being, you know, you're seeing a flash forward from this scene, you're seeing a flashback from that scene, then you're seeing what you think is real time in one scene. And it just didn't jive or to me be cohesive enough to, I lost interest in it. Almost not to the point where Girl on a Train, because that was really bad. That was just a point where they just did it in a fashion that they had this neat trick in Girl on the Train as far as those flash forward and flashback scenes. It's really didn't work out for me very well because of the way they laid out. And this one, Arrival, they didn't do it much better because it just really lost interest as far as what was going on in the now, as far as when she was dealing with the aliens directly.
Right. So as an alien flick, were you expecting more out of it? Like a lot of people were comparing it to maybe the same kind of crisis situations as like Independence Day. What were you expecting when you went into it?
It was not anywhere near an Independence Day. Now, Independence Day was over the top and cheesy and bombastic and something Michael Bay would love, but it was still like a okay popcorn flick. Even the latest Independence Day that came out last year, that again, it was even worse than the original, but it still had some sort of popcorn flavor. You could sit through it and, okay, it's a thrill ride. We get it. Okay, maybe it's a little bit bombastic and over top, but and has your eye rolling from time to time. But at least it's got a flow and an action to it that help keeps you into the moment from time to time. Whereas with the Arrival, I saw no sense of danger. The individuals and the government were obviously afraid, and in reality, we would be afraid for various reasons. But I just, as an audience, we are not sympathetic to what's going on because it just did not seem that they were making the aliens any threat at all, even though the government itself was very afraid by it. And you just don't believe the government being afraid by it because they were just presented as literally just a docile race.
And that's where all of the politics come in. But that's a whole nother podcast right there.
And then also check out your review on it on popculturecosmos.wordpress.com. So if you want all the words in writing about how Josh at the time felt about it, and felt about how the reviewers loved it, and felt about those reviewers loving it, you want to check out popculturecosmos.wordpress.com.
See, you're a much better co-host than Justin. Like with you, I don't even have to plug my own stuff. You can just do it for me, which is nice.
Well, it was good because I read it. It's a very good piece. Whether you agree or don't agree, which, you know, a lot of people are doing these days on various things, at least it's very well thought out and very well written, where you can understand your point of view on why you don't like it. So if somebody is an ardent supporter of the movie, they can at least understand your point of view and then respond back to you in kind with their thoughts in a respectable fashion.
Exactly. See, it's all about debate. It's all about polite debate, I guess, is what I'm trying to say there. Okay, well, let's take a look at the news today, or not today, but this past week. We have Sam Worthington is back in the news, and it's been a really long time because all he's been wrapped up in is Avatar stuff recently. And speaking of Avatar, this is what
That's because his career went in the toilet.
He's
been waiting for an Avatar.
I like Sam Worthington, though. Like, I can think of a whole lot. Anytime I'm, like, hearing them casting something in Marvel, I'm like, you know who would play that really well is Sam Worthington.
But it's just like this. Okay, we all know he did Avatar. It did great. You know, Buko, you know, props to his agent. Here we go again, me propping an agent. But he got those roles in the Terminator movie. He got the roles in the Clash movie where he was lead. He was making lots of money. Great, great. But then you saw the diminishing returns going down. Goes from star to a co-star to a supporting cast. Is that in Heartbreak Ridge, supporting cast, correct?
Correct.
So there you go. Now hopefully this will reignite his career. You know, playing in 15,000 straight Avatar movies, that'd be great. But from there, it's just so hard to stay on top if you don't get the right roles. Yes, you go for the cash as far as if we were in that situation, but trying to stay in that great higher upper echelon and have those choices. I mean, Chris Pratt, you know, he's been able to do very well since, even Passengers notwithstanding, he's been able to do very well as far as staying at that level to keep his name status. So none of the Marvel characters have really been able to do that. Talk about Chris Evans, talk about Hemsworth, whatnot. When they try to branch out, they don't do very well. You can name it right now. It's just there's not that many bankable names in this business. And Sam, you know, was an individual that for a little while could sell a movie.
Yeah, I mean, with him, I think it's your typical Taylor Kitsch situation where the actor has potential to be really good, but I think it's just the writing. Like a lot of the movies I've seen Sam Worthington in,
Well, Sam Worthington, you know, like I said, his choices, you go for the big money, And I can't blame him. You know, if we were in that situation, it's you got to do what you got to do. So I don't blame him at all for doing it. I just know that when you do that, things like that, is you got to pay a price. And unfortunately, the cause of diminishing returns was just that. You have to keep going. I do want to make a correction, though. Robert Downey Jr. has had some success with the Sherlock Holmes movies outside of the Iron Man films. Now, mind you, he's had some issues as far as diminishing returns with due date. And then there's the one where he did with his dad with Robert Duvall.
Which was a good movie. Did you see it?
No, I didn't. Like I said, it didn't move the needle. That's why, like, you know. I'm sure I'll be seeing it on cable very soon, but it's not something that actually did very well at the box office, the choice it makes. But still, if you were to make another Sherlock Holmes movie, it would still be good enough to make a nice little profit.
True, fair enough. And Benedict Cumberbatch is also up
Now you have to include him into that Marvel universe. Okay, let's put him on that realm and see how – well, how many movies has he carried so far?
Just one. So I get what you're saying.
Yeah. No, which one did he carry? If you're saying Doctor Strange, that's
– that's the only one he's been in. So, you know, there's not a lot of like
– everyone, he's been either a co-star. Into Darkness, he wasn't the – you know, he wasn't the draw. Well, the name Star Trek was the draw.
The Imitation Game? Didn't that one win him a bunch of awards?
Yeah, that did as far as from an acting standpoint, but as far as from a bank home, let me check that out while you're doing it, but I don't think it did, you know, buku bucks on it, but I may be wrong, and I'll correct myself on air while you're going on to the next subject.
All right, well, okay, back to Sam Worthington. He came out and said that Avatar 2 will be a family saga, and they're about to start putting that together. He said the film will take place 8 years after the first one and will focus on his offspring. James Cameron has just finished the script for Avatar 5, and the films are set to be released in December of 2018, 2020, 2022, and 2023. So my question to you, Gerald, is do you think that planning four Avatar sequels based solely on the success of the first film is a good idea?
And the answer to, as far as The Imitation Game, it made $233 million worldwide. And obviously, it, even though there's been no reported budget for it, I could say it probably made a nice little profit. So I will stand correct on that. But he is not by himself at this point in time, even though he's an excellent actor and I really like watching his stuff. Can sell a movie 100% on his own. Maybe he's better now in place. Now he can, but than before. Now that he's had Doctor Strange in his back pocket, so we'll see. And then Sherlock Holmes TV shows, he's done very well with that as well. So in your question regarding Avatar, if I'm the studio, it's hard to say because, you know, James Cameron has a, you know, he has a history. He has that track record. And I'm sure he is helping in some form or fashion to finance the movies as far as so that it can get done, because it will probably lead to bigger returns if they make that kind of money. Again, this is something we've talked about before on the podcast, because the podcast, I've talked with you about it. I've talked with Rob McCallum about it, as far as the diminishing returns of Avatar, as far as the pop culture license that you can continually go to and understand and remember fondly. I know there's going to be a Avatar Land at Disney World coming soon, and that they're devoting a good portion to it. But is there too much of a time frame lost so that people will get interested again? We've seen over the past couple of years, especially where franchises, movie franchises, have come back with a long-awaited sequel, quote-unquote, and the people just have did not go to the movies to see it. That's something I've seen as a trend the past couple of years as far as movies are concerned. I think the second one will tell the tale as far as people, if they want to go back to it. But I still think it's the same as Rogue One. If it does half of it, what are you talking about? Almost 2 billion? I'll take that. You know, I don't think it will do that. I think an Avatar 2 may still do over $1 billion. And if that's the case, if you're going to give a movie company that much clout as far as a $1 billion movie in its pocket, I think it's okay to go ahead and okay all the rest of those movies based on the previous success of the $2.8 billion. Because, like I said, even if it goes down by half, even the first time out, you're still talking about a $2 billion franchise. And if it goes down half again, you're still talking about a $1 billion franchise for the third one. And the other two would probably, you know, go maybe $700-800 million after that. So I'd take it. Why not? They'll cost $300 million each, but I'll do it. Why not?
Because I don't hate Avatar, and I don't either,
but it's not something I went, I saw it, it's all blue. The special effects were cutting edge at the time. It was great. I really, really love Stephen Lang's performance in it. That is the movie to me. His evilness, that was one of the best bad guy performances of this century as far as films are concerned. And people don't laugh at me when I say that. When they actually look at the movie, the acting itself, the story itself, yeah, it's nice. It tells a feel-good story and all that, but nobody really cares until Stephen Lang comes up there and just, you know, as an actor, chews that scenery with his evil, you know, twirling, almost if he had twirling his mustache as he was doing it. Instead, he was drinking a coffee and saying, let's go home by breakfast and whatnot. So, and get this done and destroy their land. So, and he was relishing in the performance as far as from the standpoint of how good he was in that role. And now that you don't have him anymore, spoilers for an 8-year-old movie, it's kind of, to me, he was the most interesting character. So now I will be going into it even less interested than I was before, because I'm not into Sam Worthington's character. I'm going to be honest with you. Sigourney Weaver, who is the only other one that actually had a decent character in the film, she's, you know, her character.
They say they resurrected her.
Okay, well then there you go. But still, I mean, I'm sure I will go see it. I predict the kids, whatnot, if it's still allowable. Although it's pretty violent, the last one. I guess it's okay to go, but I'm not going to go. I don't think the audiences out there, they're not. It's not Star Wars. And this is something again I talked about with Rob with Star Wars. It's just not going to appeal to a large audience in the way that they don't have the fondness for it that they do of Star Wars. They'll go see it in mass, but Avatar is the kind of movie at this point. It's a type of pop culture identity that you can go see it and then you instantly forget about it. And that's maybe over the long haul, not the kind of identity you want.
Right, and that's what I was getting at. It was that a lot of people who I've talked to about the movie, the first one, it was a visual feast to them. All of them agree that it's a visual feast, and they went to see it because they were more curious about it than anything else. But I asked them if they remember anything from the story, and they're like, they don't even remember there being a story, hardly. You know, they remember the key moments, Sigourney Weaver dying, the Stephen Lang. The fight with Stephen Lang and the big battle sequences, but they don't remember enough about it to really show that they were into the writing of it. So it's an interesting creature to me because it's the sequel is really going to tell whether or not the next three are going to be, you know, hits or misses with audiences.
And that's the thing, because technology now that they used in the original Avatar, what is now pretty much, we've seen it. You know, we see it on any big budget movie that's out there. We see it with the Star Wars movies that have come out since then. That type of, you know, cutting edge technology is no longer cutting edge. So when we see the next Avatar, is it going to be interesting and compelling enough? Is it going to be a visual feast that we're looking for? And I'm not even sure if it's going to be that as well. It's just going to be something that everybody's going to be seeing for a while. And because it's Avatar, and then, you know, they may have it as a Blu-ray coming down the line or an HD Blu-ray to make sure they can test out all the colors on their HD TV, the 4K that they got, the Ultra HD with the, you know, the high res imaging. And that's pretty much it. You know, it's just like I said, it just will not leave that lasting footprint you really want to leave, like Star Wars does.
Right. Exactly. All right, so next in the news we have Gore Verbinski is actually having a very difficult week.
He didn't have a great weekend either.
Yeah, he's A Cure for Wellness is out and it's not doing so great. It's actually currently number 10 in the box office, but you know, he did shed. Do you remember when they were back in 2008? They were talking about a BioShock movie.
Yes, I remember that. And you know, Ken Levine was taunting it quite a bit at the time.
Yes, and they pulled the plug on it, and nobody really explained why. It was kind of had a few news articles on it that were less than a paragraph, and then we never heard anything about it again. So he finally, during the premiere for A Cure for Wellness, was asked by a reporter about what happened to the film. And he said the plug was pulled 8 weeks prior to being made. So this was back when it was a risky ticket, I guess, to make a rated R movie. So Universal wasn't sure about the R rating, and they didn't know if, because of the R rating, if they wanted to dump that much money into creating this entire universe of Rapture, which would have been fantastic to see on screen, but...
I agree.
Yeah, and it was basically... So what turned them off of the film was the combination of the price tag and the rating. So it's one of those films, it's kind of like when Microsoft tried to sell the rights to Halo. Nobody wanted to take a risk on it because Microsoft wanted so much of the profits, and there's that big stigma with video game-based movies. So nobody really wanted to take that risk. Do you remember that?
I do. And Steven Spielberg was once attached to the project. And that's pretty much when they decided they were going to go to that made for almost like TV, but made for their basic video game audience through the Xbox. It's when they made those, you know, self-contained films, not the films for theatrical release, mind you, but the video series that they launched, which didn't do so well. It was really looked kind of bad on both occasions that they tried to do it. The first one was a little bit better than the second time they tried to attempt to do it, but they both didn't quite meet up to everybody's desire to have a Halo on the big screen. Sorry, Master Chief over there. But it was just a very disappointing thing to see when they finally pulled the plug on it, because like you said, yeah, Microsoft wanted, you know, their hands in the too much in the kitty. It was just disappointing to see that all came down like it did, but not surprising in the least. You know, it was Microsoft.
So would you have liked to see a BioShock film? I mean, if they make one in the future, would you go watch it?
I would watch it, but I would have them try to distance themselves as much as they can from the video game, because the video game itself is now almost 10 years old. So if you're going to try and relate so much of it to the video game, the casual audience isn't going to remember that it's based off a video game, and they're just going to find the stigma that it's a video game based movie. If you make it now or sometime in the future, just try and create it on its own laurels and its own strengths, with maybe some hints and some ties, small ties to the video game, but you don't want to do anything really overt as far as that anymore, because the BioShock series is right now in a state of flux at best. Most consider it dead and gone. I'm thinking it will still revive itself at some point in time. But yeah, BioShock, if it were to come out as a movie, I would try to make it stand on its own laurels and not try to like Assassin's Creed, have it, you know, trying to tie itself so closely to the video game audience.
Right, it's kind of like the Silent Hill. That's what I would have imagined it being like. You had your gamers who love the video games, and then you had people going and expecting it to be this elaborate horror movie, and it's just got too many tie-ins that they don't understand.
See, the Resident Evil movies, you know, I know we bash them all day long, and they're, you know, critically they're not very thought of, but it's made over $1 billion as a series. Why? I mean, because it's tried to do its own thing, but still have some ties within the, you know, the Resident Evil universe, like the T-Virus, Raccoon City, you know, at least some of the characters or whatnot. But it really doesn't feel like it's a Resident Evil. It really doesn't feel like it's having to tie itself down to the Resident Evil game. You look at all the, you know, the movies in the series and whatnot, it just does not feel like they had to tie themselves down to the video game series. And you almost forget that these characters are from the video game series when you watch them on screen, because they're so very loosely tied to their actual video game counterparts. And if BioShock were to come on screen, I think that's the route they should go.
Yeah, because, well, I mean, that would be an easy route for them, just because there's not a lot of characters in BioShock. You know, you have Alice Ryan, but he's really the only thing that holds the franchise together. Next in news, we have Arnold Schwarzenegger is not going to appear in the Predator sequel. Were you hoping for that?
Get to the chopper!
It would have been a great little piece of, like, you know, fan service, but the other movies were okay without him. You know, we don't know, but you don't see anyone.
He's too busy pushing Mobile Strike. Well, I'm sorry. And his, you know, Celebrity Apprentice thing too.
Which I haven't been monitoring the ratings. You've been talking to the TV ratings guys. How's that doing currently?
It's not what it once was, as the, you know, individual that sits in the White House constantly loves to tell people. It's not what it once was ratings wise, but it's still on the air for now. So I guess you could say that's something.
So do you think that Arnold is going to make a bid for president after a few seasons of this?
He's unfortunately not eligible to do so. So,
oh yes, that's right.
Yes. He cannot.
Especially now.
when he was California governor, he had made some inklings, I believe, from my understanding, that he was supposed to, you know, going to try and see if that could be curtailed so that he could make a run. But no, it never came to fruition. But there was that thought. He did have that desire. I'm pretty sure I can tell you as a fact that okay, well, I'm sorry, facts. You know, you say it's, can't say that these days. So I can say it's fake news. But I'm pretty sure that he had a very good inkling when he was governor of California that he wanted to take that next step.
So Boyd Holbrook, who is starring in the film, he has said that. Boyd Holbrook.
I'm sure we'll know him soon if the movie's ahead. So.
Yes, exactly. We do know who Shane Black is, though. So, you know, Predator, it sounds like it's in good hands.
Depends, you know, who's Boyd Holbrook, you know, that if, again, there's not too many individuals that can carry their name with their movie. I get that. But people still have to have some type of name recognition when it comes to these bigger budget, larger budget features. Am I wrong in that?
No, you're definitely right. I don't know what else he's been in. Like, I haven't really done a lot of research on him, but it has.
If you have to go to IMDb, then there's a problem there.
There's a problem. But if you look at the supporting cast, so he has Olivia Munn, Keegan-Michael Key from Key and Peele. He has Thomas Jane from The Punisher. And I'm not sure who the other two are, but
Jane should have been the one that
he should have been the lead. That's what I was thinking.
I mean, maybe he's a little bit over the hill now. Maybe he's not doing, you know, those type of movies in that fashion. A lot of stuff he does goes direct to video. I get that these days, but you know, he is a bigger name in the industry as far as that might be able to do it. But then again, this may be a hot actor that we don't know about yet, but we'll know soon by the time the Predator movie comes out.
Hey, you know, Thomas Jane, you blame him, got to make that paycheck.
Yes.
Okay, but my question to you before we move on to the next topic is, do you think, so the Predator franchise has had its ups and downs over the years. Let's not talk about Danny Glover. Do you think that this...
I like Predator 2. I'm sorry. I like Predator 2. Okay. I've got a great Predator 2 story.
Okay. I'm going to have to hear it. But my
question. You're on it.
So let's talk about Predator 2 story. I'm curious. I didn't know if you wanted to go on it. So I
don't forget your question though.
Okay.
I don't want to throw you off track. I don't want to throw you completely off the rails.
It's written down right here. So okay,
cuz this is the Double J podcast. So
yes.
I want to make sure. Well, again, for those people that are old enough, and unfortunately I qualify, the Predator 2 was one of the first movies to hit the cinema, to my knowledge, recollection, and I'm not looking this up, I'm not Googling it, this is going off my brain, that instituted really Dolby Pro logic as far as Dolby surround sound experience. And yes, there's been speakers in the back of theaters and the front of theaters for a while, but they really couldn't give you that full surround sound like experience, that full digital surround sound experience, you know, in earlier days, 70s, 80s, whatnot. It wasn't until right around the time, was it late, early 90s, 1989, 90-ish, whatnot, when Predator 2 came out. Can you look that up? I'm sorry.
For Dolby Digital?
No, for Predator 2. Thank you. So Predator 2 comes out. It's the first movie I actually sat in the theater for. It's one of the first, to my knowledge, that came out.
1990.
See? Did I call it?
Yeah.
So if it was one of the first that came out, then out to my knowledge, and I sat down with my friend and we're sitting in there in the theater and we're watching it. And it's actually not that bad of a movie. And, you know, it does have Bill Paxton. It has a lot of recognizable names, Ruben Blades and whatnot. It has a lot of recognizable names. It made it for a decent flick. Okay, the story gets a little hokey and whatnot, especially the ending. I get it. But to actually be in there and for the first time hear that surround sound experience where everything's zipping by from the back, you know, through the back of your head and to the side, left, right, boom, boom. And I'm just, and the theater was so kind to make sure they turned it up to 11 instead of a 1 out of 10, which, you know, made it even more just like, well, I can't hear now, but back then it was really cool. So you got this whole experience going around in surround sound cinema, boom, 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 whatnot. And I just thought, man, I said, this is just some awesome
Could you hear Gary Busey's spittle flying out of his mouth as he was talking?
Pretty much. Even when he started screaming as he was about to meet his end in that icebox scene there. So, yes, that's correct. He was just, his spittle was, you know, flying away, and you could actually hear it all in beautiful Dolby surround sound. So I turned over to my friend. I said, this is some really awesome, you know, blankety blank stuff, isn't it, man? And excuse me. And he says, I said that, and I turned over to him as I said that, and he was asleep. It's one of the loudest movies I've ever been in, one of the loudest experiences. And like I said, one of the first experiences in the theater with Dolby surround, and people know now these days they take it for granted. And, you know, we can go to Best Buy or we can go to a local stereo shop and get that same experience. But back then it was really neat. And he's asleep.
Hey, some people fall asleep in loud noise. I fall asleep to screamo music. So it's just everyone has their thing, I guess.
I fall asleep after I listen to the Pop Culture Cosmos podcast and the PCC Multiverse about 10 times in a row.
And what time are those shows on and what days?
The Pop Culture Cosmos show is on every Monday night, 7:30 p.m. Pacific, 10:30 p.m. Eastern on the Podcast Radio Network. It's the number two program overall and the number one show on Monday night. And the PCC Multiverse, the latest addition to the Pop Culture Cosmos scene, it is available on the Podcast Radio Network at 4 p.m. Eastern. And 4 p.m. Pacific, 4 p.m. Pacific, 7 p.m. Eastern. On the Podcast Radio Network. And also you can download those on 8 different audio formats. And that's just, you know, and if you do, you usually get a bonus thrown in there too, like on the show.
Hey, there it is.
Yep. Cheap plug. Thank you. Hey, yes. I was just, I'm like, man, this is some awesome. And then he's asleep. So I don't know. I have a soft spot in my heart for Predator 2. And Bill Paxton's whining, yo, man. No, he took that from Anal. His Aliens character pretty much put it over into the Predator 2.
We're screwed, man. Hey, Bill Paxton's the man.
There you go. Even today.
Even today.
Yes. Even okay. Training day.
All right, back to my question, though. My question is, do you think that this new Predator – this soft relaunch of Predator, they're trying to kind of do what Prometheus did for the Alien franchise, as in try to start something new, but also have it expand on the mythology at the same time. You know how we kind of got like a soft little reboot with Prometheus?
Well, we also got a soft little reboot with Predators, if you remember that. That came out four years ago. Yeah, 4 years ago, I think, if you remember. Do you remember?
It's something like that. But I liked Predators, but I don't like how the movies are the same over and over and over. Like with Prometheus, I like that they expanded on the mythology of all of it. But so what I'm hoping for with this new Predator movie is that they kind of expand on the Predators and like where they come from, what motivates them,
how do they become just hunters and go after all these different races and, you know, treat it like sporting game and whatnot. You want that aspect of it.
Exactly. Get like, you know, put some meat on the film.
Instead of just all these individuals telling you that they go and do what they do and have it seen from their perspective, just like in Predators where, you know, Lawrence Fishburne. Was it Lawrence Fishburne?
Yeah, he was the crazy guy in the ship.
Yeah, that was telling Aidan Quinn, about their history and whatnot. And then in back previous, you know, others telling about, let it be from their perspective. If they do that, that would be different and that would be kind of cool. I might like that. You know, it's I'm sorry. It's hokey.
That was a pretty spot on impression of the laser beam.
Yeah, the original one was really hokey, but it was just fun.
It's classic.
Yes.
It's classic.
Yes.
Yeah, I love the classics.
Get to the chopper.
To the chopper. Yes. All right. Next topic of conversation. Lionsgate is working on a new Robin Hood movie. And before we go into detail about this, let me...
My head hitting the floor.
Yeah, you saw the Ridley Scott Robin Hood, which was actually really good. Do you think that we need another Robin Hood? It seems like a lot of this is like unnecessary retelling.
Is it a retelling of Robin Hood Men in Tights?
No. It's the same exact story as Ridley Scott's. Like, Robin Hood comes back from the Crusades and, you know, things aren't the way he wants. Like, the greed and corruption. This is the film is being directed by, what's the guy's name? Otto Bathurst. I don't know what
else. Is it a reboot of Robin Hood Men in Tights?
No.
Then there you go.
Not interested.
Yeah, if it's I'll tell you what, if it's like the Ridley Scott one, which wasn't bad at all, you liked it, I thought it was okay. In fact, it was just on the other day on TV. Yeah, that's not a problem. If it's the Kevin Costner one that was overly cheesy, I don't know about that.
But if it was like the Ridley, if it is like the Ridley Scott one, why make it? Why don't we just go back and watch the Ridley Scott one?
People are hoping that you know, every 10 years they can refresh those familiar characters and see if they can get something out of it. I mean, 10 years from now, they'll try another two Hercules movies again after they both didn't meet the expectations. You know, 10 years from now, they'll go after another Santa Claus movie just to, you know, see if they can do it. Every 10, 15, 20 years, they seem to recycle these old traditional characters, like another Snow White movie, you know. They'll try to see if they can go ahead and do that again. It's just every 10, 15, 20 years, they just think they can go ahead and con a new audience into watching those films. And I don't think it's going to pay off.
Hollywood and their fads. I am kind of, you know, not excited, but like, I'm curious to see Taron Egerton in the role of Robin Hood. He was good in Kingsman. I think I want to see him in something else, see how good he might be. But I bring up this topic because in an interview, Otto Bathurst said, "To be honest, when this film was first offered to me, I turned it down immediately. The world doesn't need another Robin Hood film, as we said. We've had enough. But when I started to look into it and investigate this man and the legend and the story seem more relevant today than it has ever been. For me, making a film is about reflecting on what's going on at the moment to bring back something to humanity, to society." So he went on to say, basically, it's going to be a political piece. So it's going to be like Arrival, I guess we're talking about, would be a good example. Ryan Murphy, the creator of American Horror Story, said in an interview this week that the next season is going to be on this year's election. So by the time Trump is done in office, I get people hate him, that's whatever, but do you think the entertainment industry is going to be so oversaturated with anti-Trump, anti-right-wing entertainment pieces?
Liberal, as far as
liberal, yeah, liberal pieces that people are going to just be kind of not burnt out on it, but just not in the mood to go watch it. Because if I want politics, I'm going to open up Facebook and just look at my newsfeed and just depress the hell out of myself. You know,
I agree with you. People are going to get sick of it really fast, both from the right and the left. It's going to be the same story. Something comes out that's going to lean heavily toward the left as far as its message and opinion. People from the right are going to argue about it and cry foul and whatnot, blah, 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 blah. People on the left may support it for a little while, but after a while, there's too many films. It's just, you know, it's like anything. If there's too many films trying to say the same message, and in Hollywood where it's very liberal, it's very left-wing as far as that's concerned, you're going to get that. You're going to see that probably within, you know, the next few months to a year. You're going to see that type of imagery. It's going to get old after a while, and it's going to be the same thing. Somebody protests, why not, don't go see this film, left does. somewhere there's a happy medium. But then after a while, nobody's going to go see these films because they just, like you said, are tired of this message because they see it in the news. They see it on, they, as soon as they click on the internet, they see it when they go to their social media, Facebook, Twitter, what have you. It's just all over the place. It's there's not going to be a great tolerance of going to see things with this, with these same type of strong messages if they want to go to the movies to escape.
Exactly. And I don't need to go in to see a movie and find another reason to like hate the person sitting next to me. It's just not good for people in general. But okay. And on to the, let's talk about Logan real quick before we go on to box office numbers. Logan, I don't know if you've been reading the early reviews, but I haven't. I've been trying to stay away from the spoilers. I just read the headlines. That's all. I haven't opened up any of these articles because I don't want to know. But it has been getting fairly positive reviews with critics during early screenings, which is good considering that Fox was extremely worried about the R rating, and they've been vocal about that. But it, at the moment, it looks like it's paying off.
It is. It's garnered excellent reviews so far. They say it's a great way. I keep on seeing the same theme, and that this is a great way to end the Wolverine franchise. Although, as I've said before on previous podcasts, if 20th Century Fox and Marvel and Disney could just sit down for lunch one time, just if we can, they include one character in the Infinity Wars. Just do Wolverine. Just let him borrow from like just for a couple movies, just like Spider-Man is with Sony. It'd be awesome that he would still be in the mix. And he has not entirely ruled out something like that. He said he's retired from doing it full time. I get that. But if it was some scenario like that, or something similar, he would not maybe say no to it. I know Patrick Stewart has said clearly on the record that it doesn't want to be done with his Professor Xavier as of yet. So I'm hoping that this, he's not done with this character entirely, because I think it would be, you know, it's going to be hard to fill those, you know, claws, I should say. So I would say maybe, you know, go see him now, because this is going to be the last time you see him in Wolverine, at least on a full-time basis through a full movie anytime soon, if at all. My hope's still high that they can do something smart and try and see if they can work something out with Marvel and maybe appear in the Infinity Wars, if not the first, then the second one in 2019.
That was actually going to be my next question to you, with like the, if Logan is majorly successful, he's not, I don't see Hugh Jackman hanging up the claws for good, especially since I know Ryan Reynolds is kind of bothering him about the Deadpool.
Well, yeah, he said he wouldn't be entirely opposed to doing Deadpool, especially the way, you know, he's obviously taking good fun the way Ryan Reynolds mocks Wolverine and his character so much, you know, in the previous Deadpool or whatnot. So I would say maybe doing a cameo, he would not be against, but I don't think you would see him doing a full-time thing gig with the character again. I think he's done with it, because it takes a lot of work, I guess, for him to become that character as far as physical and whatnot. And at his advancing age, maybe it's not as easy as it once was. And maybe that's why. But I'm hoping, you know, he will do something in the Deadpool universe. But I'm also hoping that cooler heads would prevail and be able to do something in a larger Marvel universe as well.
That would be rad. Okay, so we are going to take a short break, and when we come back, we will have some box office numbers for you, the good, the bad, and the
wellness.
And the wellness. Yes, correct. So stay tuned.
If you're tired of sifting through flea markets for rare and unique games, we can help. Retro City Games in Henderson, Nevada, only 5 minutes from the Las Vegas Strip, has all your favorite gaming staples, classics, and a wide selection of rare games, with new stuff always appearing on our shelves. Come in and chat with Nicole or Doug about your love of games and watch as they help you complete your collection or find your childhood favorite. And don't forget, Retro City Games loves trade-ins. So if you have any Nintendo, Super Nintendo, Sega, Xbox, PlayStation, or even PC games, come in and visit Retro City Games today. Welcome to the new metropolis of gaming, Retro City Games.
All right, welcome back to the Double J podcast featuring Josh and Gerald. Let's get into some box office numbers, huh? You want to do the honors here of the first few names on the list?
Fair enough, indeed. At number one for the weekend, and well, what's going to come in with a big rally as far as for the entire 3-day weekend, because I got to remember we got to play Monday into it. Monday should be larger for family audiences and whatnot. Let's go with the Lego Batman movie. And the Lego Batman movie is going to be winning out. Right now the estimates are for the 3-day weekend estimates going to be around $35 million. 50 Shades Darker still holding up a little better than its predecessor as far as from a percentage standpoint. Money-wise overall, no, it's not touching the original. But the 50 Shades Darker is also coming in at around 21 for the weekend. Let's go with next with the highest new entry on the list, The Great Wall, which I want to talk to you about. I want to get into that one here in a sec. That one came in around $18 million for the 3-day weekend. And then also John Wick Chapter 2, that's coming in at about 16.5. That is held strongly. That is definitely good news for John Wick fans out there like you and I. And then last in the number five position, Fist Fight, which was expected to do higher. So it was a slight disappointment for Warner Brothers. That came at a $12 million over the weekend. And it looks like you'll be able to take it from here from number 6 through 10.
Right. And let's talk about The Great Wall for a moment.
That's indeed, because that I want to ask you a question. What's the difference between The Great Wall and Warcraft?
There isn't one.
And that is the correct answer.
That's the big thing with me, because everyone is like, you know, they made a big deal out of the controversy that Matt Damon was a white man in an Asian film. And you know, he in the film, he's not supposed to be Asian. Like, he's a European who's come just to check out what's going on. But that's another debate. But
it doesn't bother people in China going to see the film. That's the thing.
Exactly. But people are going to see this movie. They're like, oh man, this movie's disappointing. I don't know what did they expect from it? You basically get remember that movie that came out? This was maybe 5 or 6 years ago, called Dragon Wars, which was really just about dragons attacking a city. That's what The Great Wall is.
But this set in time is obviously used, and I think the fact that it uses The Great Wall as its, you know, emphasis on it kind of sets things in a different tone as far as, okay, it's using this Great Wall that we all know is one of the great wonders of the world, and using it in a fashion to make a cheesy sci-fi flick or fantasy flick, I should say.
Right. And that's, I don't know why people were expecting something big from this.
Well, I don't know how they could say expect something big outside, because there was really not going to, they're all indications were that it was not going to trend very well outside of the Chinese audience. They were pretty much banking on that audience. And to their accountability, it's made a pretty good amount. It's garnered over $200 million internationally, and it's going to have to do the best it can to earn everything in China and the Far East, because it's certainly not going to make much here, similar to what happened with Warcraft.
Yeah, it's, and on the flip side, it's the same thing. Like, you know, when you make a kung fu movie, it doesn't do so well over here, but it ends up being really good over where it was released. So The Great Wall, I expect they'll make their money back from it, but at the same time, I don't know why people in America, I don't know why they're going into it expecting this big, this big thing, but it's not really what it is. It's just you get what you get from the trailers.
Indeed. I couldn't agree with you more than that.
All right, so back to box office numbers. I want to go through the back half because the last movie on the list is just something I want to touch on briefly. Hidden Figures is at $7 million, bringing its total to $142.5 million. So that's been...
That's a very, again, like I said last week, that's a great job. I really think audiences should be, pleased with the way the movie came out. It's a very good movie, deserves all the recognition and fan support you can get. And I think it really, really harkens back to a great time where there's people that support a movie with very little fanfare that comes out that did not laud itself during the holiday season as a possible Oscar contender or whatnot, yet manages to do so. And not only top of that, deals with positive subjects. It's a positive movie. It's a good spirited movie. And then also ends up making a nice amount of money at the box office.
Yeah, definitely. For something that was relatively unknown and still is kind of unknown to people, it's packed a powerful punch in the box office. Coming at number seven, we have Split, which made $7 million this week. And from what I understand, it's almost had a sequel greenlit. I know Disney and I don't know who produced this one, but Disney and whoever it was, they're trying to settle on a contract. So M. Night Shyamalan.
But Shyamalan, he finances his own films.
Yeah. But I mean, the properties are owned, like Unbreakable is owned by Disney. So in order for him to make the sequel to Split, which was supposed to be a sequel to Unbreakable, they need to come to some sort of arrangement. So that
Disney own the characters?
He doesn't own, he owns the characters he's made in Split, but he doesn't own the characters from Unbreakable. So he can't.
But what about the bonus scene at the end where
he was given permission.
Okay.
From the studio to do it. He doesn't have the rights to have them in an entire feature film. So that's a conversation. And I imagine it's going to go through. I know Disney's greedy, but I imagine there's still enough money to be made out of it to make it worth the while for both parties.
Because Samuel L. Jackson has already stated in interviews this week that he is very interested in reprising his Mr. Glass role.
Right, right. And fans are eager to see it. I personally want to see it. I haven't seen Split yet, but I'll probably watch when it hits on demand. But yeah, I'm eager to see an Unbreakable sequel.
As am I, definitely. Because I remember that movie. It was, again, with Shyamalan, he does have to have his twists and whatnot. But at least in Shyamalan's effort with Unbreakable, it was something that a lot of people could get into.
It was a very mellow twist. Yes. Compared to most of his movies.
You didn't realize it at first, but then it's like, oh, okay, I get but I can hang with it.
And it wasn't one of those things you're mad at, like in The Village. You didn't feel like cheated out of your $12. All right, coming at number eight.
Or The Happening, where, just the trees kept controlling your mind.
All I remember from that movie is the lawnmower, the guy trying to kill himself with the lawnmower. I did too. That's the only scene that sticks out. Okay, coming in at number eight, we have A Dog's Purpose, $5.5 million, totaling in at $50.6 million. This movie is not doing so good just because of all the controversy surrounding it, and rightly so. Coming in at number nine, we have La La Land, $4.5 million.
That'll teach you to treat your dogs nice.
Yeah, seriously. Anything you do, thanks to cell phones and social media, any like sin you commit is going to get out there somehow. So don't think that. People shouldn't think that they're above it. It's just your sins will always come to life. Somebody with a cell phone somewhere is going to film you doing something bad, and it'll make it onto the internet eventually. All right, so let's talk about number 10 on the list here. We have A Cure for Wellness making $4.2 million. Is this a bad sign for Mr. Verbinski?
Well, it's a bad sign on projects that it's not have certain big budget connotations to it, such as, where did he come from? As far as the movies that he was making, the names that he was attached to. And then he goes ahead and goes into A Cure for Wellness. And it wasn't a cure for wellness for sure. It was not a cure for a good movie either. So, unfortunately, it didn't work out for him. He needs to go back to Pirates of the Caribbean very, very quickly.
He's going to be tied to that franchise for the rest of his career.
It's about the choices you make. We see in Hollywood, you know, you make those a lot of times when you make, okay, let's say Ghostbusters, that which you're directing, that becomes a humongous hit worldwide, $200 million plus, blah, 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 blah. And then instead of making a Ghost Toaster sequel, you want to make a cure for faleness. So you make that, and because that's the movie you want to make, what you love doing as far as the art in you and whatnot, but nobody wants to see it. But you're self-satisfied with the fact that you created something for yourself and what you wanted. But with a studio that's trying to back you with X amount of cash in order to do the film, they're not so happy. So obviously they're not happy cab purse tonight with the way A Cure for Wellness is done. So if Gore Verbinski looks to go ahead and do those type of films in the future, he better supplement them back with big budget blockbuster features such as the ones we've seen him do with Pirates of the Caribbean.
Right, and I think a lot of those artsy projects need, you know, to have a, before they do that movie, they need to do something corporate in order to get their money to make that. So it's a vicious cycle. You make the money and then you spend it on something that doesn't do so well. And poor Dane DeHaan, he's about to be the next Sam Worthington. He was cast in Amazing Spider-Man 2, didn't do what people wanted it to. Then he was in I don't even know where I was going with this, but he's in another movie and he just can't seem to hold his own. So the Valeria and the City of a Thousand Planets or something, that needs to do well or else it's not going to, his career is probably just.
That's from Luc Besson, correct?
Yeah, of The Fifth Element. And
that's another one I'm scared about, then that might go the way of the one. What was the one with Channing Tatum where
Jupiter Ascending, right? Is that the.
Yeah, that's the one. That's what I'm afraid it's going to be.
Yeah, me too. I hope differently. I like The Fifth Element, but it's just. It's not good to like, it's not really safe to bank on newer projects these days, as we talked about last time. Okay. We're going to take one more break. And then when we come back, we will have some, what's coming to theaters this week and a trailer talk. So we'll be right back. Stay tuned.
Check out the number 2 show on the Podcast Radio Network this Monday night, 10:30 p.m. Eastern, 7:30 p.m. Pacific, and later that night, it'll be available for download on the ESO, Tangent Bound, and Gunna Geek Networks, and also iTunes, Google Play, Mixcloud, Stitcher, TuneIn, and Podcast.com. Thanks so much, and we truly appreciate you listening. This is the Pop Culture Cosmos.
All right, welcome back to the Double J Filmcast featuring Josh and Gerald. Coming to theaters this week, we have a doozy of a list, only one of which people are probably going to care about. I'm just going to go down the list because there's not really a lot of talking points here. Bitter Harvest, Collide featuring Nicholas Holt, Da Crazy Pimps with a Z, Drifter, Erasing Eden, Fabricated City, Get Out, God Particle, My Life is a Zucchini, Punching Henry, Rock Dog, Sargi, Tulip Fever, Voodoo, A Year by the Sea. So a lot of these titles, you're pretty much getting what's in the title, if I had to assume about these movies.
This is just an amazing list. Actually, probably it's even better than the list you had last week and the week before. This is probably when they invented the movie medium, this is exactly what they had in mind. You know, that ever-present list of, you know, those hits, incoming hits that's going to be on the screen, such as, you know, Da Crazy Pimps and, of course, My Life as a Zucchini. You know, what a world this is when we have a week where Da Crazy Pimps goes against My Life as a Zucchini coming out of theaters.
Oh, it's going to be an intense competition.
Backed with, having a Bitter Harvest as well.
Yeah, exactly. If you don't like those, you can go punch Henry. It's up to you, whatever.
Or you can get out.
Yeah. I mean, at least on the, on the plus side, at least this week we can pronounce all the names. So you just got to, you got to pick and choose your battles a little bit. Okay, hey, so let's talk about trailers. Have you seen Colossal, the trailer with Anne Hathaway?
Yes, it's all right, but nothing that overwhelmed me at this point in time. But then again, the trailer's still young. It's there's still more coming to back it up as far as seeing whether it's something that's going to click with me and click with general audiences are concerned.
Well, it's not, I'm just going to tell you now, it's probably not going to be a good movie, but it'll be entertaining.
Okay.
I think that's what
Looking
they
already
want
into
it
the
to be,
future.
I guess. Like, no, I mean, it's just one of those movies. It's like Zombievers on Netflix. Like, people are going to go watch it just because it's looks kind of over the top. And I like Anne Hathaway, and I hope that she eventually returns to greatness. But for now, she's making her run on the indie circuit. Next up, we have Dean with Dimitri Martin, which actually, did you watch the trailer for that? It actually looks good.
No, I haven't. Tell me a little bit more.
So he's this kid who his dad is mourning the loss of his wife, and Dimitri Martin is plays Dean, he's not mourning his mom, and he doesn't know why. So it's like that whole kind of, it's not really coming of age, but it's kind of a soul searching movie with that unique brand of like awkward comedy that is Dimitri Martin. So he reminds me of Zach Braff in a way. Like this movie reminds me of Garden State.
Oh yes, I knew you were going to say that as soon as you mentioned his name. So definitely something to look forward to indeed, if that's the case.
Yeah, so I'm hoping it doesn't disappoint. Ghost in the Shell with Scarlett Johansson. Have you seen the new trailer for it?
You know what? I'll tell you what. Yes, I've seen the latest trailers for it. I have seen the TV spots. I will give them this. If the movie still fails and it still falls flat in its face, it will not be because of publicizing the movie. It will not be because the movie commercial or the movie trailers didn't get out enough. And it's not because it wasn't put in the eyes of social consciousness and the casual audience out there. It's because people will just don't want to see this film. It's been on the Super Bowl. It's been already in national TV and whatnot. We see it all over the internet as well. So at least my props to those who are running the actual PR for the film, because they've really done a great job. And whether or not this is going to translate into a really good movie event, we'll have to wait and see.
Is it something that you're looking forward to personally?
No, not at
Okay.
least in a film standpoint, not at least in a theatrical standpoint, but I will watch it when it comes to video.
From what I saw in the trailers, it looks like it's pretty much hit for hit the original anime film. So I'm curious how they're going to, because that was a really confusing story. It was good and it was fun to watch, but it was a really, really, really confusing story.
But it also reminds me a lot of Aeon Flux with Charlize
Oh,
Theron,
jeez.
and that's what I'm afraid of as well. It veering off into that direction as far as having the best of intentions, but unfortunately the worst of executions.
So for this one, we should hope for the best, but prepare for the worst.
And then here comes your favorite movie.
Go, go, Power Rangers. So they released the final trailer this week for Power Rangers. It didn't really, it had maybe a couple lines that were
It
different
needs more
from.
trailers.
It needs more trailers. Definitely more trailers. Are you gonna go see this? Is this something that you think will sit well with people of the generation that came out in?
If my girls want to go see it, I may be interested in seeing it. We'll have to wait and see. I'm not. I was still already an adult when the Power Rangers hit it big in the 90s, so I'm not really that. This didn't really grab me when it came on afternoon TV, and I already saw the context of it. Personally, I like the mashups where, as far as mirroring Japanese television, if you want to do that, watch MXC. That's to me the best use of Japanese television ever. But that's my opinion. But the as far as the Go-Go Power Rangers are concerned, the Power Rangers. Elizabeth Banks is one of the best actresses out there right now, and that leads me to hopefully one of these days I want to do a piece on a great film from the 2000s that I wouldn't say it's a great film. It's a very good film. It's a very enjoyable film. It's one of my favorite films, but I won't say what it is because it's going to ruin the article. But if I ever get around to doing it, I want to say it's one of the most influential films of the modern era because of how many stars it's emanated from. I may have mentioned it before in a previous podcast, and I probably did, so you could probably look it up. But I think that her character, if she's allowed to do what she needs to do, it could be good enough to carry this film into a hit status. But it has to be reliant on her character, and also Bryan Cranston. But Bryan Cranston's role is going to be a little bit subdued just because of the nature of who he is in the film.
Right. I'm not expecting anything out of it. I'm more than eager to give it a try. Like, I will gladly go give it a try. I'll probably go maybe the week it comes out to see it, but I'm not expecting anything great from it. So, all right, that will do it for the Double J Filmcast featuring Josh and Gerald. Gerald, is there anything you would like to talk about before we close?
Well, I just know there's some pretty good films. Logan is probably the best thing on the market right now that's going to be coming out in the near future. Right now, there's actually some good films out there. If you haven't seen John Wick Chapter 2, if you haven't seen the Lego Batman movie, they're both getting strong reviews. They're both doing well at the box office. These are films that you actually should go see in theaters, and you will have a great experience in seeing them. Like I said, after Logan, it gets a little bit dry, but then Fast and Furious, the next one, that's what I'm gonna call it, the Fast and Furious, the next one comes out, and then we go in from there. But I think we're just all waiting for Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2 to come out and rock everyone's world.
Because that's kind of like the jumpstart of the official summer blockbusters.
Indeed, yes. The first week of May usually kicks it off, and that's to me really what I'm waiting for as a movie fan. But there could be some decent stuff on the way, so we'll keep an eye out for you right here at the Double J Filmcast. If, of course, the single J here lets me back on the show at some point in time.
Of course.
If not, I will mention it on our other shows, the Pop Culture Cosmos Show, which you can find every Monday night at 10:30 p.m. Eastern, 7:30 p.m. Pacific on the Podcast Radio Network. And then also the Double J, but also as well the PCC Multiverse, which you can listen to at 7 p.m. Eastern, 4 p.m. Pacific, also on the Podcast Radio Network, or you can download it off of iTunes, Stitcher, Podcast.com, Google Play, Mixcloud, the ESO Network, the Tangibound Network, and also the Gunna Geek Network as well. And I had to close my eyes so I could remember all of them.
I noticed. Are they on the back of your eyelids?
Yes, because it's like a rolling transcript, like right, coming right through my eyebrows.
And if you like the Double J Filmcast, Humanikin Media has several other shows which are featured prominently on the Pop Culture Cosmos. We have Chad and Travis's musical show about music. We have the Super Bro Station Games Cast, and a brand new show coming at you called What About This, which I'm actually really excited about, mostly because I don't have to be on camera. I'm producing strictly, and I have full confidence in the people who are on screen debating things. So stay tuned for that.
Oh, that might be, that is either going to be awesome or like a grease fire. But anyway, it's just like a car crash. You got to watch it and listen to it, right?
Hey, exactly. But I'm excited about it. Hit or miss, it's, it'll be an experience.
Yes, I'm doing the logo now as we speak.
Yes. What about this?
Yes.
All right. That'll do it for today, guys. Thanks for tuning in. We'll have another episode for you next week, which may or may not feature Gerald here, but most likely will. So thanks for tuning in.
All right. Have a good one, everyone.
That's to us people that can feel things, it hurts.